You're listening to the audio production of Artpreneur, the step-by-step guide to making a sustainable living from your creativity by Miriam Schulman, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by the author. Every time you state what you want or believe, you're the first to hear it. It's a message to both you and others about what you think is possible. Oprah Winfrey. Chapter 1. Choose to believe. In the hot Atlanta classroom, the backs of my thighs stuck to my wooden desk chair. I was pulling a stray thread from my hem when my fourth grade teacher, Mrs. McNair, held up a piece of green felt over her white, frothy hair and drawled in a thick Southern accent, "Does anyone know what this is?" My hand shot up as I blurted out, "An eighth!" Mrs. McNair peered at me over the edge of her half-moon spectacles and pressed her thin lips together as the other kids sniggered. Apparently, the correct answer was a fraction. Annoyed, I slumped back in my chair and resumed picking at the hem. As the new girl at school, I hadn't quite caught on that it was time to swap dresses for denim shorts. But I knew an eighth when I saw it, the same shape as a perfectly sized piece of pie. Later that day, she pulled me aside. At first, I thought I was in trouble for calling out in class, but instead, she explained that every class in the elementary school designed a jack-o'-lantern for Halloween. My fraction outburst had demonstrated a good understanding of shapes and proportions. So she wanted me to be the class artist and design our pumpkin. This marked the first time in my life that I had been called an artist or even thought of myself that way. Like Harry Potter being named a wizard for the first time, artist was a label that caught me off guard. Yet, it made perfect sense. This new identity explained my unique ability to look at an ordinary piece of felt and see something others could not. And from that moment on, I began to see myself differently. The simple truth was, my teacher declared that I was an artist, and I chose to believe her. Eventually, this belief drove me to answer the call. Perhaps you felt that call as well. To declare oneself an artist isn't easy, but believing in yourself is a critical part of the belief triad for selling your art. We'll get to that in Chapter 3. Answer the call. If you felt that call and are struggling to sell your own art, I get it. There are countless business courses to take, gurus to follow, tech tools to choose from, and numerous conflicting voices about what you really need to be successful. And there's a lot of bad advice out there, which is why I want to help you cut through that noise. There has never been a better time to turn your creative ideas into a successful business. The art world gatekeepers no longer decide what is worthy. The internet has leveled the playing field. Today, anyone with a laptop and a dream can make a sustainable living from their creativity. So why are so many artists still struggling? Many artists just lack a solid foundation in how to market and sell, or are so overwhelmed with information that they're doubting their next moves. Many artists are both confused and overwhelmed with too much conflicting advice and no idea about where to start. Artist plus entrepreneur equals artpreneur. In this book, we refer to anyone who practices any of the creative arts, such as filmmaker, novelist, poet, sculptor, whether it's done professionally or not, as an artist. Regardless of your talent, you were an artist the moment you created your first finger painting or twirled in the yard to your own happy made-up song. There's no magic fairy or fourth grade teacher who deems anyone an artist. You get to decide to wear that crown. You can be an artist and create for fun, but if you want to make a thriving living out of it, and become a true artpreneur, you'll need to develop the mindset and learn the business skills that entrepreneurship requires. In this book, you'll get both. Many of my examples will come from the world of visual art, the one with which I'm most familiar. However, the advice here is derived from the business world. The elements of business success are for all entrepreneurs and all artpreneurs, no matter what kind of art you create. The elements of business success. In building a sustainable business, the five core elements of your business that will drive your success are production, pricing, prospecting, promotion, and productivity. Together, these elements comprise what I call the passion to profit framework, which forms the foundation of all successful businesses. Many artists struggle as artpreneurs because they've got a problem in one or more of these areas, and worse yet, they often misidentify the problem. We'll dive deeper into each area in Chapter 5 and uncover common mistakes that lead to art marketing malpractice. In addition, Chapter 6 through 11 will go deeper into each element, with two chapters dedicated to helping you learn how to actually sell your art. Now, what if I told you that the biggest factor impacting your ability to build your business is confidence? Would you believe me? Deep down, I bet you know that if you had more confidence, it would unlock all kinds of opportunities for you. Confidence runs along a spectrum, which I call the belief scale. And where you land on the belief scale will either enhance or impair your ability to price, prospect, promote, and continue to produce your art. Throughout the book, you'll be guided through thought work exercises that will help you identify when you're having thought distortions and replace limiting beliefs with empowering artpreneur thinking. Your mindset controls everything, and when you have positive thoughts, they generate the emotions you need to act. With a positive mindset, you can take the bravest actions, the ones that make the most difference. When you believe in possibility, those positive thoughts motivate you. Conversely, when you lack belief, you'll feel discouraged, which dampens your motivation and inhibits action. Your thoughts drive how you see the world, how you perceive others, your choices, and ultimately your actions, which determine your results. Creating an abundance mindset is the sixth element you need to succeed. This book will help bolster your mindset and confidence so that you will. Confidence building is baked into this book to kick the starving artist mentality to the curb. In Chapter 7, you'll even get 14 abundant artist lessons when it comes to pricing your art. Limiting beliefs. Many artists have one or more self-sabotaging thoughts. I must confess, at one time or another, I didn't believe I could make a living as an artist, which is why I never went to art school. Saddled with student loans, I took the practical route and headed for Wall Street. Although I loved the income, I felt disconnected from my life purpose. After 9/11, I knew I couldn't remain in the corporate world. Yet at the time, I didn't believe I could make a full-time living from my art either. That self-defeating thought held me back for many years. Any thoughts that inhibit you from taking positive actions are known as limiting beliefs. Sometimes we're even aware that these unwelcome thoughts aren't true, but often we perceive limiting beliefs as facts. For example, you may be thinking, I'm not good enough, or no one wants to pay high prices for art. And to you, this feels like a fact. However, this exaggerated all or nothing way of perceiving a situation is a thought distortion. In many thought distortions, a seed of truth masks the limiting belief underlying it. So what's the difference between a limiting belief and a thought distortion? The late psychologist Dr. Aaron Beck, who founded the principles of cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, recognized that people have core beliefs that are a result of our upbringing, cultural and social conditioning, and life experiences. All of us have a belief system that stems from our core values. However, we also have what Dr. Beck called self-defeating beliefs that get triggered. Throughout this book, we'll refer to self-defeating beliefs with the more common term limiting beliefs. Moreover, Dr. Beck's work demonstrated that people have what he called cognitive distortions. I prefer the term thought distortion. When we have a distorted view of reality, we may think thoughts that are overgeneralized or black and white. Since limiting beliefs are based on your belief system, you can't prove them to be true or false. For example, you might have a limiting belief that people shouldn't have to pay high prices for art. Or the earlier example, I'm not good enough. These statements cannot be proven true or false because they're opinions. On the other hand, a thought distortion might take the form of people won't pay high prices for art. Since that's a belief that can be proven true or false, it's easier to question it. Psychiatrist and CBT pioneer Dr. David Burns writes on his blog, "When you challenge and defeat a distorted thought, you feel better in the here and now. When you challenge and change a SDB, limiting belief, you change your value system at a deep level." The thought work throughout this book will poke holes into many of your established beliefs, which will create a change in your thinking. Your results will reflect any limitations you believe. Therefore, fixing even one thought distortion will unlock all kinds of success for you. Throughout this book, I'll help you recognize your thought distortions and limiting beliefs by calling them out and suggesting thoughts that will be more helpful. Meet Faye, an artist from Baltimore who started working with me during the coronavirus pandemic in 2020. While she was still working full-time as an event planner, she was satisfied with sporadic sales of her art that she did on the side. But once she was furloughed and newly divorced, Faye was determined to turn her art into a full-time living. She had been selling her figurative paintings for under $50 each because she believed that cheaper is easier to sell. However, in all of 2019, her art sales had totaled a paltry $300. I told Faye that the very first thing she needed to do was raise prices on her art and create larger works that would command even higher price points. Frowning, Faye admitted, I'm afraid of what people will think. She proceeded to list all the reasons why this strategy wouldn't work for her. When she noticed my raised eyebrows, she stopped talking. Cue my New York brand of tough love with an unapologetic New York accent. If you want a small hobby, keep painting small and asking for small prices. If you want a big art career that can support you and your children, you'll need to dream big and paint big with big price tags to match. For all women, the pressure to stay small is tough conditioning to overcome. Proof of this is everywhere, from distorted Barbie dolls to the billion-dollar weight loss industry, constantly hammering women with messages to be thinner, i.e., smaller. And according to ABC News, most fashion models that we admire meet the criteria for anorexia. On the other hand, boys are delivered the opposite narrative. The typical male Disney character is a muscular brute, whereas the Disney princess is a fragile waif. Of course, body dysmorphia is a rising problem for boys as well. These messages of size affect more than just our waistline. Society is essentially telling women to take up as little space as possible, a disempowering message on all levels. This is also quite evident on public transport, where men...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.